How you doing?
Hi, Steve. Steve Dalachinsky.
Doing. I'm completely, well, I can't say completely, but technology and I don't really get along well, but I'm on a list, and a guy named Seamus Kane wrote me an email, and he wanted to buy a couple of my books, and I was surprised. I didn't know who Seamus Kane was. And anyway, Seamus and I developed a kind of a email relationship through this list, and then one day, Seamus, through email, hooked me up with Dylan, and that's how Dylan and I met in, what do you call it, virtual schmata? And then one day, Dylan and I met in real, and he was wearing schmatas. And I really love Dylan. We met in December in person, and it was kind of really great. Was it great?
It was great.
Oh, it was great, yeah. And I live in Bengal where there's lots of sex clubs, so you can imagine how great it was, right? Okay. Enough of that. So I'm the first half I'm going to read, except for one piece, I'm going to read pieces written in Paris over the last couple of years. And one was actually written in Paris a couple of weeks ago. I was kind of doing this descriptive writing, and after I'm done reading that one, I'm going to read seven words from that one that a friend of mine from Germany extracted and made a much better poem out of. It's going to be an interesting experiment. So anyway, the first piece I wrote, if none of you, most of you live here, I don't live here, I just come here a lot, but if any of you have never been to the Gustave Moreau Museum, you should all go. It's a really fantastic experience. So this is called The Island of Gustave Moreau. In a time of beasts, there is the beast who knows not, and the beast who knows, and the beast who knows he is a beast, and the beast who knows he is not. Gustave Moreau was very fond of monkeys and other beasts, but particularly monkeys and their closest rivals, humans, but particularly women and angels. Oh, he liked elephants and horses and lions too, the occasional serpent here and there. What is the law? Not to walk on all fours, that is the law. What is the law? Not to eat meat, that is the law. Upstairs with the big windows where there is no light, what is the law? To wake up every morning, that is the law. This was written listening to one of my dear pals and favorite musician Cecil Taylor in Battery Park in New York, in a place called Castle Clinton, which is a place where immigrants came through. And the interesting thing about Castle Clinton, it was built to protect New York, and as the poem says, it was built for a war it never fought. So it was never actually active as an actual fort. Tell this dynamismos, useless blues and pinks and mentis. This is daylight when we most need it, when there is no day left. This is river in a shadow, shadow against an evening when tree becomes sky. No mental can the shadow stay this silent for so long. The bricks that never saw the war they fought for. It is a yellow in the eye, useless magenta that crosses our lives. The sun is behind me, it heats my neck, dynamismos contrarios. One immigrant says to another, I passed through here too, via velitsef feast and live tale tales tale to taste, aventus creatus rolled a compet, the act of natural act of, I've come through here too. The shadows never move, the trees and sky are one, glass and stone and steel a building make, fingers make things happen. One immigrant says to another, glass, stone, and steel are the building blocks of this world. Traitor, trapped inside the gullum, a wink, the paper asleep, I crumble. In uniform, your day begins like this. Shadows never move, sun behind your back, useless magenta, bricks that tell a tale, fingers make things happen. Running spotlights cannot function before the night arrives. It is really not the clock that determines transition that crosses our lives. One immigrant says to another, it is when the sun crosses our backs like a river, a festival, a world. Sonic, telling, panic. It is when the light that was created becomes the light that was invented. A bed earned, a wise trade, a gorge traversed. Money is the mangle. Money is the mangle. We will not be fed by sunlight alone. Even now, as evening turns, snort the concessions. No time for this, that. It's obligation. Look, it's dark now. It feels so dark. One immigrant says to another, feel my neck, it passed this way, this is no joke, privatize my sacrament, it's cool now, hands on, it's cool now, this useless magenta adds to the piano's song. This world was built by hands, tree and sky no longer touch, the shadows have become a river that does not flow, brick is what I call your face, I remain attached to my allegiance. Tea is a drink for two, three. This shifting desire is a wedge between the clock and the hours. Clamusen, Torista, Reditsula, Bois. Such useless appendages, these hands against the unmanacled day. One immigrant says to another. Okay, I'm going to go through this one really fast because the one I really want to read is the next one. So I used to stay near the Pompidou, and now I've been staying in Pigalle, literally across the street from Montmartre. I mean, that's what's so interesting. I'm in the 9th, and you cross the street, and you're in the 18th. I mean, that's like a lot, 9 to 18, that's like double. I still can't figure it out. So anyway, one of the great streets when you walk is that fantastic Rue Martyr, pardon my French, okay? Rue Martyr with the stores. And I discovered in December while I was here when all that snow happened, a great little passage, and at the back of the passage was a school for little girls. And the school was, someone told me the school was called École des Rues des Martyrs. I don't know if that's true, but that's what this is about. And then I'll read you his version. All that remained was one black glove where the children just seconds ago played wildly like a tribe. Unruly yet semi-disciplined, white bourgeois. I stood transfixed, watching them chase each other about, frenzied, shouting. 5-year-olds at most, in the yard of the small private school, they never noticed me. It was the first sunny day in 2 weeks. All that remained of the previous day's blizzard was the wet slickness of cobblestones they trounced on, one child sliding every now and then. Twisting, tugging, pulling, I stood, seeing into, through, beyond them, remembering nothing of such a life, but yearning for this nothing nonetheless. The old-fashioned hand pulled the bell, and the bell rang, signaling the end of recess. In the recesses of my memory, I remembered this. The children rounded a corner and disappeared one by one, until finally all that remained were two. The one small child in the hooded red overcoat who had desperately tried to fit in somewhere, and a taller, seemingly older girl in yellow who held tight to the back of her coat, pulling, tugging, not letting go. her coat stretching like a flare in the cold air as she tried desperately to escape. Finally, she was released, the yard now empty, but for the silence of dripping water and one black glove. Yeah, it's not that bad, but you know. we'll get to his version real quick, because I really want to read that one. All was white. I don't know how to read it, because it's his. All was white. I stood frenzied. All was stones twisting. Life finally empty and black. That's pretty good, too. It's a different poem.
Small.
I know. I've never been one for economy now. Okay. Which water is which?
That's yours.
Oh, is that mine? Okay, so stay where you are. Every time I come to Paris, I keep a journal and give the journal a name. The journal of the journal that this piece was written in is called The Veiled Doorway, which was the title of an obscure drawing by Ensor. And it's in a lot of parts. I'm not going to say part one or part two. I'm just going to kind of read it. But the first part is in a square Georges Kane, which is a little park by that great museum. Never mind, we'll just read it. Square Georges Kane Revisited. Here circling by accident, foxglove on fire, fox hunt long gone, she is still and still naked, prolonged movement in midst of floral, Camille's sad smile, a decollage, ageless perfumed paste, amazed patisserie willy-nilly, May is near, and like there summer arrives too early, sans spring, and already on its way out. She holds out her virginity like loaves of bread, a veiled doorway, always. I secretly, the charming veterinarian, a stained glass angel of sorts, bodiless and bottomless, a happy black and gold clock, all negra, stopped at 11:05, holding up my tobacco pipe for a whole generation of lost puppies. Entire generations of blank duchesses, blanched elegances, destroyed and donated notations et scene de rue, offering a plan of evacuation, a carrier of caskets of foreign matter. Do the math, it's simple as light is simple, as 10 cats on burning stilts is simple, and rolling all fire down a slope simple. As the transmission of images is simple, storming the Bastille is, simple artillery, as demolition and reduction and pillaging the invalids, a plan of evacuation, a convention of monarchs, and here comes Miss Corday again, and there she is outside the window, hands behind her back, wearing her patina shyly, circled by the prancing youth, oblivious to her glance, ignorant of her nakedness. Even the violation of her flesh, her grave, her ashes and bones, her bones cannot make this day more spoiled, sans issues. And there she is again, trapped within sunlight, eternally on the run. Not even prehistory can stop this monolithic assemblage. Not even this century can foretell histories to come, no matter how obvious all seems. A pied foot, the royal gloomies, sex art place de Vosges. Playing with her hair on the grass, she is her lover, fountain of bodiless gargoyles, spews smoke from the mouths of long-gone winters, where you, I will follow, where you, eyes wrapped in your skin, your motion, a perpetual stillness, these diamond-shaped footprints in the sand, tread marks gone with a sweeping gesture, garden of sand, flower, tree, and grass, pigeons bathing, washing their equivalences, i.e. underarms, entire rooms of furniture up in arms, a coat of arms worn by every arboreality, a one-handed timepiece that gently turns her beauty over as old age converges on the greenery, her hair flame-colored like a fox on fire. We take off her stocking and kiss young Mary's foot. In the Place de Vosges, everyone takes off their socks, unveiling slightly passages that only lead inward. Silently whistling in the Place de Vosges, he sits to observe the carnage, a carnival of marred possibilities. E-ramble, preamble, he ambles back to a convenient spot for spying, hands behind his back, the old man squarely circling his yesterday, peeking at the young girls. The little girl in the flowering dress with a pink plastic sand pail in the Place de Vosges. A bird splashes the air with frantic voice minglings. I'm atop the tree, watching slow-moving clouds. Chimneys these days are like the four seasons. Her knees bend slightly forward, erasing circumstance. He pretends to slap his lover as they run into the circle of stone, and then as motion skidding erase all traces of themselves, spilling like invisible waters onto the sand, a mirror stranded, strands of explosionary identicals, the little boy with his gun shoots birds. When you lose things, you always think you're losing things. A rendezvous with friends, the canaries. Explore different emotions, speak to the canaries in different languages, pale orange, pale yellow, steal your own tail feathers, and from fragments of song, speak to them as if they were your friends, the canaries. Imitate their voices if possible. Get intimate. Visit their next of kin. Don't try to order their lives or yours. Act as if the door that separates you from them is clear, that the screen is only a shadow of your partnership. Spend quality time building your relationship. Eat your salad, then spread some time alone. Every day, if possible, spend some time alone. From that day forward, spend some time alone. It's simple. Don't justify your actions. Don't justify your personal life. Don't protect protection or project yourself or your failures or your successes. It is arbitrary at times to eat garbage. Also necessary to substitute one salad for another. Though despite their similarities, difficult to duplicate the original experience of that very first salad. Let the birds speak to you as you study the menu, then swallow the damn thing, gizzard and all. After sharing gossip, trading love, mimicking discussion, feigning recognition, and playing the game as children would, it's simple. The little boy unloads his weapon into the little girl's bucket. Bigotry. L'argent de deux. And the trances of life. Extinct species, the list goes on and on. Ménage à trois, a third one enters the restaurant, a darker orange, fluffer, fatter, the three share seed. VIP, RIP, viper, vapor, ripper, zipper, part two. You'll get part two later. Imagine there's no piano players. Step on the merch. God almighty. That was a difficult one, wasn't it? Get out of here. There we go. The last collage I made in Paris. It's the only one left. Going once? Gone. I was in a festival in Paris about 3 or 4 years ago, and it was a horrible hotel they put us in, and I wanted to make a collage, and there was nothing except travel brochures. So that's all made from travel brochures, and I think it's the only time in my life I ever made something like over a 10-day period, like every day. What am I getting out of this fucking hotel? it was quite an ugly hotel. I mean, the view was fantastic. What was the view? Smokestacks and trains.
We felt like we were in New Jersey.
Which was really, really, really comforting. Very comforting. Ah, just a goddamn poet from New York. Put him in a smokestack. Okay, so I'll finish. I mean, I'm not going to finish. You're out of luck. But I'm going to finish that long poem, I think. So where were we? R.I.P. V.I.P. R.I.P. Viper, Vapor, Ripper, Zipper.
Zipper.
Zipper. Duh. That's the next word, actually. Duh.
Oh, yeah. Oh.
Friendship is a give and take. You give, I'll take. Oops, my soft-boiled eggs are getting hard. Luxembourg Gardens. The relationship between gull and fountain. If I see one more bird washing itself. Self. The relationship of the self to water. Beneath the trees, possibility of being shat on by pigeons. Example. She gets shit on. It's true. Ship B, same location. The young boy's sailboat sails away. The pigeons eat pale red blossoms. Their shit is thick and orange. I didn't make this stuff up. Radical surgery on the soul. I find a decapitated geranium at the outdoor market. Red like a wound, no longer its original self, only the idea of the geranium remains. This part is actually for Marilyn, and this is true. Yes, I was born a Jew. Peanut butter and matzah. Tongue? Ring a bell? Peanut butter and matzah. Tongue stuck to palate. Language in check. And me. Identity card. Here I am, dead of the living. Two chickens for the price of one. Here I wrote my book, fed eventually the grasses and polluted the air with my ashes. My yellowing grin and unbulging, bulging bowels. Here my number was my name, Marcus Yankelevich Schwarzbots, Mikhailovici, Cass, Vichy, Vichy, wounded, crippled, and crippling cowards, Stepansky, Varadi, and Lefkowitz. The door was left open. You entered, veiled, scaled, shut tight and clean. Wajnariba, holding his pail of stone, Isidore, Wench, the Tainer, Salomon the King. Where was your strength when God went on a bender? Salaman the King, where was your strength? Zali, Georgette, Bertha. You were chosen to stand naked in the garden, arms stretched out, offering your virginities like loaves of bread, buckets of bone and flesh, smiles turned inward. Michelle, Ruth, Nicole, Paulette, Juliet, and Simone. Bu-ah-ziz-bu-ah-ziz-baj, Roche, brothers and sisters, lives sewn tight. We are no longer here for you. We are no longer there for you. Nor were you ever there for you. Both Tis, Azrael, Lazaron, the fountain is flowing. The birds have quieted, and documentation is complete. Zajach, Elelu, Najer, Nechmin, Adelstein, Leska. The indispensable verdict. Though everything moves on, nothing changes. I bend down, I find the missing hands of the clock. Time begins again, pretext for liberation. She and I, naked as newborns, deported from the garden again. A voice in my head speaks to me in another language. I do not understand. Another voice interprets it. The first is a woman, the second a man. I peer through the tense flaps, look out across the canal. She has not yet returned. Returned, her identity card. There are no children left from the past. With a sweep of my foot, the right one, I wipe away all traces. Sequenza. From somewhere, a trumpet resonates, telling me that evening has arrived. soon night, then morning, then echo. The echo will begin again, and the door will reopen. Insert drawing of a weird bird's foot. The young boy conducts the orchestra from his seat. He has managed to survive. None of the others have. None of the victims got further than their own past. He has made it to the future. She remains naked and suspended in time. She is older than he, yet younger. Mother, sister, lover. He bites her patinaed arm. Patinaed arm. Oedipus did not kill his father for nothing. Suspended in this golden liquid, hands too heavy to move, the compass travels inward. All thoughts of direction vanish. All journeys become murmuring showers of mites. Why we prefer constants. Even the duck salad is no longer itself, no longer real. Its origin has been altered. Only the memory of the salad lingers. Because it wasn't very far, and you know what far is. It's an old and absurd realm. The veiled doorway unveiled.
Oh, that's the end of that one.
I told you it didn't get funnier. Okay. Okay. This is what most of our governments are like. Sunset. There is this illusion that we are clean, though nobody's noble. Money, busyness, pain. I know these are the key. Champagne revolutionaries. The consumer will decide. It is standard practice to keep two sets of books. If you are going to be dishonest, it's good to be honest about it. After all, are we not men? I'll read one from this little Luigi Bourgeois thing. I cried for my newly dead friend in my dream. I cried because there was nothing left to say. My crying woke me up, and this was proof enough that I had finally fallen asleep. If Robert died, that means he must be dead. Okay. Is Oliver still here? Okay, this one I'm reading for you, Oliver. It's not here. Where was it? Oh, it's not here, Oliver. It disappeared. It was a Morton Feldman thingy. Uh-oh. Everybody have a couple of papers? Boy, it's weird when all of a sudden you're laughing, and then all of a sudden you're crying, and then all of a sudden... What the hell was that about? Wait. Could you see if you could find patterns in the chromatic field? It got lost.
Well, in the meantime, who is Robert?
I don't know. He's dead.
Chromatic field here.
Okay, great.
You
found him?
On top.
If in a dream, the dreamer in the dream hears a poem read by a poet in the dream, in this case a woman, thin, dark, and frail, possibly from South America, who in the dream wrote the poem as well, who then actually wrote the poem, the poet in the dream or the poet dreaming the dream? Can I, as the dreamer, when awakened by a sudden noise, reconstruct the poem, thence claim it is my own? In the dream, she intones, waiting for my next cigarette, wondering when the train will arrive, when the boat will leave, watching the immigrants come in, waiting for my next cigarette. Okay, I don't know. Okay. That's a really long one. That was all put together from dreams, actually. So I'm going to read this for Oliver, who is a musician, a conductor, a composer, and a music lover. I wrote this listening in a church to this beautiful piece of Morton Feldman's called Patterns in a Chromatic Field. A faraway train, it is fair to say, is a faraway train. Took too many shots. I lift a hand toward the beast's no-fit knife. That piece of cloth that holds my mother's smile held by scaffolding, I walk through halo held in sliver of light, cement and brick wilderness, in a temporal sky of cloud and glass and heavenly blue on mountain of stone, across tarnished silver frame, here within God's favor, held up, held on, held over, too many shots, shattered panes of ice along a street named Royale, that now must end, that now must end, nameless moments as temporal voices ask, where are you going? 381-735-698-475-608, Sanctus, come sit at my table, we are pistols in this house of worship, slow moving, it is fair to say, even as the train awaits us, a far train, a faraway train. And this is the last one, I promise. I don't like to, you know, we're all really different the way we approach our own work, and a lot of us say, oh, you know, I'm great and I'm wonderful and I'm shit and I have no ego and I have a big ego and I have a generous ego and I have a sad ego and I have a trampled on ego and my mother-in-law and my brother-in-law and nobody loves me and they don't come to ever see me and look what's become of me. Where did that come from? Look what has become of me. So actually, so this is one of my favorite pieces. That's all I wanted to say, actually. And we have a bus in New York now. There's a Chinese folks in Chinatown started these buses. Now there's millions of them. But the one we take when we go to Boston to Kerouac's home in Lowell in Massachusetts is called Feng Hua. And I have a poem about that one, but I don't know where the hell it is. But the last time I was on the that's actually in that section of another poem. The last time I was on a Feng Hua bus, the guy was smoking with one hand, listening to the radio with his one good ear, and talking on a cell phone with his other hand. But he got us to Boston. Anyway, this is pre-Feng Hua, so the bus that only took us then was called Peter Pan. So, I'm just making the setup, so you know what Peter Pan is, okay? It's called The Leaves Are Changing. Yuko tells me the time is nigh, but since Dylan's the boss, he's the one to kick me in the arse. So it's called The Leaves Are Changing. The leaves are changing. I'll try to do it with the music. It's going to be hard. The leaves are changing somewhere outside Brewster. It's rare that we leave New York, the island, but here we're moving with the changing leaves, north on interstate weeping willow, slowly changing. It's early in the season, and there are natural points of change within a given time. Cross river, we bear exit 6 closing, I-684 is that way, Brewster 11, Frawling 23, I think it said. We are borne forward on Peter Pan's back, carried, changing by people, professionals, wards of the lake and solar system, carried like stars on the poet's backs. The second best thing to do during a lifetime is to plan a revolution. The first best thing is to revolt. The last best thing is to know what you've done and why. Hard thinking like rearranging all those letters in a Scrabble box. Coke and lots of land for sale. Kerouac told Waylon in a letter dated 12-4-68, call me, Phil, call me. My number in St. Pete is 343-1541. Road work for the next mile. Don't give this number to anyone. I don't want strangers to visit me. I'll strangle them. The first thing is to plan your life. The second thing is to live it. Kerouac told Waylon to return his books. He told Waylon not to worry, to move somewhere, do something else. The leaves where they have begun to show red, show such a red, not red light or emergency, but a subtle change of life. Kerouac wants that copy of Blake's Jerusalem back. A sign planted on the cemetery lawn says, Travel Services. The second thing is to hunt. The first is to let your prey go free. Maple and fir, they never change in this water town, this highway of exits and bridges and footings. The willow chases the wind away. The wind wanders down the highway and into the small city. It rests atop one of the two main spires of the Mother Church, where angels rest, sleeping, weeping, thinking, praying. Kerouac mentions other books as well. He's drunk. He's been hit in the head with all that television made available to him. He wants to write as much as he can and read and rest and drink. He wouldn't mind Wayland's company, but he doesn't really seek too many others. Food, phone, gas, lodging, here in God's gymnasium. The last best thing about the leaves is when they start still moist, falling and forming a carpet of reds, yellows, and all the fire colors onto the ground. The first best thing is to know they'll change. The second best thing is when pretty much all of them have changed and the leaves are still on the branches. Then they start drying and making noise, and winter comes. And the trees look so cold, and you wonder, how can they stand being naked? Kerouac says to Wayland, he's gonna build a big fenced-in outdoor library in his backyard. He'll sit all day, read, write, drink Boilermakers, and look at his Georgia pine, his banyan tree, and his bush tree of some kind that it's least 25 feet tall. Well, Phil, take care of yourself. The leaves are changing, they're free, and the reds and yellow oranges are softly creeping through the greens. Listen, Phil, don't meditate too much. Food, phone, gas, lodging are not far away. Kerouac's letter is safe under glass at the public library, along with his dreams and some of the Dharma. The shoulder is closed. This life is a new town, a blasting zone, a blue colony, a diesel under glass. Maybe under glass the color won't change so much. Will not go brown and brittle like the leaves when their changes are complete. And when the blasting zone ends, the best music, the best fishmonger, the best refuges, Peter Pan's back above the clouds as the rain starts falling east on I-84. Food, phone, gas, lodging. So let's ride together into the corner of this room. Let's lie together beneath the fast-drying leaves. Let's sing deaf together, but hearing every sound. Let's blow together like the wind.